So I played the next games against Delial for Triad Wars 15 quarterfinal, and I was really exhausted that day, as you could probably tell from the prior videos, and these games were really tiring me out. So I think I recorded like the first 10 minutes of this video. I was trying to talk, and then I gave up and just went silent for the rest. And I figured I should probably record over that and give actual commentary. So we went with oops, what's happening there? We went with the an adjusted hand. I'm not sure what I played actually in the last video we showed. I can check. Whoa, I can check. I have the records. I wrote down which hands we used in which games. Because even though it's with elemental, so I'm not keeping track of move orders for my list, I did keep track of the hands used. So in game four, which was the last game before this, I had switched to a very similar hand, but here I updated it. I decided to drop 2-3-2-6 and bring in 2-1-2-6. And my reasons for this were really one-fold, but we'll pretend two-fold. One is it gives a little additional coverage of Elena's 8-1-9-7, the 9 facing down, but that really wasn't what I was trying to get. That coverage had never come up in any of the games. I'm very likely to have that card out of my hand by the time I'm dealing with Elena, and 8-7-8-4 already gives some coverage there, and that's much more likely to be in my hand when it would matter. So that's really not it. The second possible reason is that this version might land plus as well, but we saw in a previous game the 2-3-2-6 was useful for pluses. The real reason is just to have that incidental plus wall on the 2-5-1-7. That, for instance, if I started 2-6-2-1, I wanted to hinder them being able to take 2-5-1-7 at some point because I had additional coverage of that square. That was the main impetus. Secondarily, sure, it hits the 9, but I didn't really care about that. I do care a little that it's easy to take a 1. But it's not that hard to take a 3. There's the off chance that the 8-7-8-4 can't take the 3 if the elementals land wrong, and this makes it a little easier. That's another reason for it, but mostly it was just to cover the 2-5-1-7. So he has first turn, and this game he starts in 9. And around now I had kind of figured, I'm getting all second turns. This is my fifth second turn in a row. And I'm figuring out how I want to handle second turn. And I've come to two conclusions here. I think, the game I got in trouble, he played 2-5-1-7 and 9, which is why I switched an 8-7-8-4 to give additional coverage of that card. And I played 2-6-2-1 and 1. And that was the worst game by far for me. And I don't think I had an adjacent corner there, but I've kind of settled on opening strategy is stick a 2-6-2-1 in one of the corners. Or take his card with a 2-6-2-1 if I think I have good play against his captures back. And here you can see I do have good play against his captures back, right? If I play 2-6-2-1 and 8, and he plays 5-8-7-3 and 6, I combo with 2-6-7-6. If he plays 8-1-9-7 or 8-8-4-7, I can combo with 8-7-8-4. And so I have a lot of play against stuff he can recapture with, and so I was really drawn to capturing. But I'm also really drawn to playing in 3. And specifically, the adjacent corner I want to play, given that the most likely move against an adjacent corner is to play the in-between square. Well, it's really that I want to threaten the in-between square. How to say this well? I find, so if I'm choosing between 3 and 7, I find 2-1-2-6 in 3 much more appealing than 2-6-2-1 in 7. I'm not quite sure how to verbalize that, but I think some of it is my 8-7-8-4 is really good on the left side, right? It's hard for him to go in the center row. I want kind of the right row to fill up more than I want the bottom row to fill up. And there might be a case for having the bottom row fill up if I have last turn, because A8-2-8 is potentially a really decent sweeper against his hand, depending on elementals. Like, I know it looks silly on the top row, but given I have so many twos facing down, it often picks those up. There's also a two facing up, I mean. There's four twos facing up between the two hands. So it can pick stuff up there, and side to side, it covers tens really well, it covers eights. It doesn't actually cover sevens as reliably, but if I get the elementals right, that can sweep there pretty well. But I still think I want the right row to fill up much more than I want the bottom row to fill up. The right column, I mean, versus the bottom row. So I'm between 2-1-2-6 in 3 and 2-6-2-1 in 8 here. And I think I went with 3. Looking at it now, I think 8's quite appealing. If I saw this position again, I'd really consider going at 8. Yeah, I think 8 looks quite appealing. But I went in 3. Yeah, I went in 3. And I think this makes sense too. It's pretty hard for him not to give me credit for a threat of going in 6. Right, if I play something like 2-6-7-6 and 6 next turn, my 2-6s facing outwards are very annoying for him to deal with, because his 8-8-4-7 landing in the middle row can always be punished by 8-7-8-4. So he really is 5-8-7-3 to capture, but that's his only capturer, and I have two things there, and he can only really fight against one of them. And so I think there is a real threat for me to go in 6. And so it made a lot of sense that he went in 6. And there's a couple things to think about. Do I want to play, you know, do I want to commit and use my A8, 2-8, and 5? Do I want to go in 2? Do I want to go in 8? And it sort of came down to, I wanted the L. Here was my reasoning. I'm not sure I played the best move. If you told me some other move is better, I would believe you. But I thought, if I go in 5, I do set up, you know, a plus and 2. If I go A8, 2-8, and 5, 2-6, 2-1 has 2. And I have some play in 8. But I use a really powerful card, and I really want that for the later game. I'd like that to be my move next turn, because I'd like to have a weaker card out of my hand first, right? Rather than be, like, forced into using weaker cards next turn. If I still have uses for them, I want to land them as early as I can to save the better cards for late. And I wanted to play an L where I had a threat in 5, and so the natural way to do that is 2-6-2-1 in 2, which is what I eventually chose. Now, Akiyama afterwards messaged me. He thought 8-8-4-7 in 7 was an interesting move. No, that must have been a different game. That was a different game. Or was it this game? No, that was a different game. There was a 7 facing left from 9 in that game. All right, ignore me. I was expecting, I think, 4 here. I think I was expecting him to go in 4, trying to 2-5-1-7 and 4, trying to pair up some squares. But I thought I should be in pretty good shape if I go 7. A8-2-8 has safety in 7. And, yeah. If I can land 8-7-8-4 and 5, you know, he has no flips in 8. And so I think that should be probably a draw, but not bad for me. He ends up going in 1, I believe. I remember it. No, he goes in 5. If he goes in 1, I play A8, 2-8, and 5, and I've locked in a whole lot of cards. No, 5 seems like a good move from him, now that I look at it. Yeah, this seems much more logical. Note that he also covers 1, right? I don't have safety with 8-7-8-4 and 1. I can play an 8, right? I can play A8, 2-8, and 8, or 2-6-7-6 and 8, and either way I go up 7-3, but his remaining cards have a lot of captures available. And so, for instance, I play, say, 2-6-7-6 and 8, I go up 7-3, which way to play it. Probably, note that 5-8-7-3 is a plus in 4, so probably 8-8-4-7 and 7 makes it 6-4, and he covers my 8-7-8-4, and he's going to get another flip. So I ended up playing in 1, he goes in 4, gets a plus 1. I don't know if I noticed that was going to be a plus 1. I go 8, and he gets a plus 1 at the end to give him the needed flip. But 5873 is a good card. He's been leaving, you know, he left the elements on the left side open so that it could get a plus in that endgame. And I think 5 was a really comfortable way to hold the game for him. So I think my L made sense, and I think my second turn strategy made sense, but I also don't think, you know, I don't think I created any winning chances this game. He tried a different starter on me, and I think I showed I could handle it well. So we move on to game 6. Same hands. I think we've both kind of settled in on what we're doing. Let's look at the elements this time. So 8784 is rock type, and so sneakily has the plus 1 and 2, even though you can't see it. 2621 also has the plus and 2. We'll come back to that. 4231 and 8847 each have a second type. I think 4231 is light and 8847 is dark. I kept open windows that it may flash to from time to time to remind me which cards had which extra pluses. Again, I don't like the card design. It should show what the card does, but I got too frustrated last time. Let's not get too bogged down with that. Again, I got second turn. This is the sixth game in a row I have second turn. I would really like to get first turn. He starts 4-2-3-1 and 7. And again, I'm kind of given a choice, right? I want to go adjacent. Now here, if we're adjacent corner, if we're going to go 1 or 9, based on last game, the instinct is 1 with the 6 facing out. But I think the problem there is the 8-7-8-4 is much better on the left side than the right. And you could imagine the board filling up kind of badly for both the 8-8-2-8 and the 8-7-8-4. You know, last game he went on the right side and he kept 8-8-4-7 and 5-8-7-3, which were good at, you know, aiming towards the right side. But if he goes on the left, those cards have high values outfacing, and I'm a little weak going left. So I think this made a lot of sense as a different try to attack me, right? If you're playing the same hand, you're going to try out different starters. You're going to vary a bit depending on the elements, but you're going to try to throw different things at your opponent. And here I didn't like the look of one. I, in general, don't find 9 as appealing. I think I'm trying to make the game a little more side-to-side than that gets us. So I think this game I ended up settling on 8, because I also noticed, you know, their captures are bad. Much like last game, I considered going an 8 against their 9 starter, but I decided I liked 3 more. Here, I considered 1, but I didn't like how my cards were angled, and I thought they were angled better in a downward than a leftward game, and by going an 8, I could force that. So I believe I went an 8, which is a move I quite like. I would definitely repeat that if we had the same position. Now, interesting position for him. It's hard for him to go in 4. It is perfectly possible, like, something like 8-1-9-7 and 4, I combo from 1, and he plays 8-8-4-7 and 5, and that ties. Like, often that is a tie. Here, I bet it isn't, but I'm not entirely sure. It might be. Anyway. We don't need to spend time on that. The point is, like, it's pretty hard to go in 4. You really have to be very confident of your calculations. And, yeah, anything else is kind of walking into stuff. So, the only way to get the worst card out of your hand, 2-5-1-7, is kind of to play 2-5-1-7 and 9. But then, I just have a lot of ways to attack the board. He doesn't have kind of any potential safeties, right? And if I play 2-6-7-6, say, in 6, I threaten a same in 5, and also, I guess 2-6-7-6 did give up one of my captures. Then he could consider playing 5-8-7-3 in 4. Though, actually, I have a plus against that with 8-7-8-4 and 5 as well. Yeah, so it's really hard to work around. And so, I he made the move I thought was best when thinking during my time. He played 7, but he played in 7 in a way where I couldn't use 2-6-7-6. And so now, I spent a while thinking about 2-6-2-1 and 4, but I didn't like that I didn't have double captures in 5, even with the plus 1 on 8-7-8-4, just no double capture. I really thought, like, if I go there and he goes, say, 8-8-4-7 and 1, even though he has weak cards left, I didn't think I was getting much there. Akiyama I said he messaged me about the last position. I was wrong on that, but he did message me about this one. He thought 2-6, 7-6, and 5 was probably winning. And when I first looked at it that day, I was like, oh yeah, I'm not sure what he would do there. Akiyama gave the line after 2-6, 7-6, and 5, 2-5, 1-7, and 6. What was the move he gave for me? I think just a8, 2-8, and 4. I think that just wins. Because the point is my 2-6, 2-1 lands really well in 2. If he plays in, say, 1, I play 2-6, 2-1, and 2, and because of the plus 1, neither of his cards can actually take it. Okay, 5-8-7-3 can, but if he stays with 5-8-7-3, I block 2 with a different card. But if he wants 8-8-4-7 as the sweeper, 2-6-2-1 cannot be swept due to the rock element in 2. So that was a clever idea. I also saw that, I think the line I checked in game was 2-6-7-6-5, 5-8-7-3-4. I thought 8-7-8-4-1 was good for me. And if I saw that line, I probably should have been tempted by doing this. But even that doesn't work. So the line there is 2-6-7-6-5 from the position we're looking at. 5-8-7-3-4. 5-8-7-3 is overworked, right? It's his kind of only card with downward power. He doesn't have another way to capture in 4. So 5-8-7-3-4, 8-7-8-4-1 is safe. But he has 2-5-1-7-3 at the end. And actually 8-8-4-7 is all the captures he needs to hold the tie. Another line I found when looking at it after was 2-6-7-6-5. I think there's just 2-5-1-7-2, just going for the T with 5-8-7-3 is a really powerful sweeper, and you can check the lines yourself, but I'm pretty sure that one ties as well. So I don't think that one was... It might have been a better attempt than what I did, but I do not think I would have won the game playing that attempt. Another move I strongly considered was A8-2-8-4. I do not like using that powerful a card early, but notably he has used one of his more powerful cards. He still has to get 2-5-1-7 out of his hand, and it lets me keep a whole bunch of threats while playing something that is safe, right? And, you know, he can't really set up against it. If he goes in 4, I'm happy to block 5 and grab 8, right? So I was kind of tempted by that, but I also just thought letting that much power out of my hand is... not that great chances for a win. And I ended up getting really into this idea of 8-7-8-4-6, just going for the capture, and that's what I played, so let's talk about that. Because I thought it was an interesting move. Because my idea was, if he goes 5-8-7-3-3, right, the obvious thing capturing me, and he doesn't have a way to set up, like, more than one combo, so I just kind of just had to check that. If he doesn't go there, I probably block 3 myself. But it's risky to do. But I thought, if he goes 5-8-7-3-3, which is really tempting, he goes up 6-4, and I play 2-6-7-6-5. I go up 6-4, right? He only has the card in 9 and 3. I'm up 6-4. And he's used his down power, right? I've made my card in 7 safe. I thought I was winning there, and looking at it now, I think that probably is a win for me. If he goes in 2, I can play A8, 2-8, and 4, and I win. If he goes in 4, he only captures one card, and if he does it with 8-8-4-7, I can play 2, and if he does it with 2-5-1-7, I can play 1. So I got enamored with this trap that I thought, like, 3 doesn't actually work and it looks appealing. But the more I looked at it, the more I thought, like, I'm creating risk for nothing. Delhi is not going to play in 3. And why am I taking on this more dangerous, complex position when I could have played something like 2-6-7-6-5 or A8-2-8-4? But I really was trying to, like, I thought this didn't lose, and if it didn't lose, I should give him some chance to screw up, which is something Delial is really good about doing, of giving his opponents some way to screw up, and I thought I should try to do that as well. But I think this was not a smart version. I think this was just needless risk. I like my move in 8 a lot, and I think I had a whole bunch of pleasant choices here, but this wasn't the one, and I probably should have gone with 2, 6, 7, 6, and 5. I don't think I would have won that game, but I think that also gave my opponent a chance to screw up and without taking on significant risk to do so. So I don't like this move I made here. Deli, this will shock you. He did not fall for it. He played 2-5-1-7 in 4, which is quite a creative reaction, saying he's leaving 3 open, and if I block 3, he gets 5, right? He's not just going to take 5 and let me get in 3, right? He's finagling it. Oh, there was points that... Yeah, if he goes 5, he can grab 6, and I don't have to recapture. But I think I usually have A8, 2-8, and 4, and then 2-6, 2-1 again. Getting that plus in 2 is helpful. I think there were traps in 5 as well, though now I'm forgetting. He goes 4. I think I block 3. And he plays very quickly here. He's calculated it out. 5-8-7-3 has that plus in 2. But I do grab in 1. And... we do get a tie. So those were the ties in games 5 and 6. I think it was probably better for me to talk this out here rather than just put up a video where, you know, it's an hour 15 minutes and I stop talking, you know, around the 10-minute mark because I just don't have the mental energy to both talk and play at that point that day. I find it very difficult playing Deli. I was thinking a bit about our stylistic differences. And I think there were lots of times, and in games where you have the audio of me saying it, but also games where, like these two where you don't, where he made the move I assume he'd make, because I think like good players often see the same moves as appealing and the same moves as strong. And there are a bunch of positions where we see things similarly and play similar moves. But there are some positions where we see differently. And I think it comes down to a few things. One is, I think... he is an optimistic calculator, and I am a pessimistic calculator. And that's going to lead me to, though I totally failed to here, and I don't like this move I made in 6. This was fundamentally an optimistic calculation, right? It was saying, I think this works, and it gives my opponent a chance to reasonably screw up by going in 3 or 5. It makes a real chance for them to mess up. I'm giving myself a way to win. Now, I do think he judges the risks on this better than I did here, because again, I don't like walking into combos like this and using a really powerful card to do so. I feel this was completely unnecessary. But I do think it's an example of something I usually don't do, because I usually calculate kind of pessimistically. And if I don't find a win or obvious safe pressure, I will usually just take a safe tie that doesn't do a lot. And I think Delial looks for more opportunities to do stuff because he calculates in a more optimistic way. And that helps him find some really creative and genius moves that I miss. And it also, at times, makes him less consistent, right? It's going to cause more wins and more losses. As an optimistic player. And as a pessimistic player, I try to minimize losses, but that can also minimize wins. I think that's one difference. I think another difference is I am more concerned about grabbing things on board, and Deli is more concerned with keeping powerful cards in hand. And that doesn't mean he always does so, right? He played 8-1-9-7 and 9 and kept 2-5-1-7 in his hand. And that was to achieve something different on board. Right, there's obviously going to be times when, you know, he's going to make the good move whether or not it fits some stylistic attribution. As I said, in a ton of these positions, I think we played them kind of like he made the move I would have made if I was in his shoes, and I suspect vice versa. Incidentally, the match is not over. I'm recording this. These are the most two recent games played. I'm recording a few days after we played them, but we have not played since. I don't know what happened in the match. I'm just thinking about our strengths and weaknesses and trying to keep that in mind as I think about how to play the rest of the match. What was my other point? Yeah, but he is also less of a stickler for which cards are going to have value, right? I'm generally assuming, and my hand is, you know, more stratified, right? The level 10s are much stronger than the level 5, which is much stronger than the level 1s. His hand is more varied, right? oftentimes the 5873 is better than the 8197, right? Him using the 8197 here was not using the second best card in his hand, it was using the third best card in his hand. And he made sure to keep the second best card in his hand, but I think he's also more dynamic than I am in figuring out which cards are actually the most valuable to hold on to. And so I put more effort into getting something advantageous achieved on the board, and he puts more effort into making sure he has advantages later on, and he's also more dynamic in his thinking about what those advantages later on could be. On the other hand, I think I've chosen a hand that makes those decisions somewhat easier for me in a way where hopefully it doesn't, you know, prove a relative weakness, right? Is there anything else I was thinking that I wanted to add here? I thought I had some other thought circling around the brain. I think these hands line up well for me. If we look at kind of incidental plus walls, and just, I believe in the 10-10-5-1-1 structure, but if we look at the incidental plus walls, his 5873 has some play against my 8 up. His 8197 has some play against my 8 up. His 2517 has a little play against 6s to the right, and his 8847 has a little play against 7s to the right. His 4231 also has play against my 8 up. My 8 up is the weakest number in my hand, right? The most targetable. But if you look the other way, my 8784 has play against 3 of his 7s to the left and his 9 down, right? And it's 10 sweeps, right? He has nothing that can fight the 10 unless I land really badly on the elements. Like he gets a plus 1 and I get a minus 1. My 8828 has play against his 8 to the left. And its 10 is not quite unbeatable, but pretty close. My 2621 and 2126 do not have much incidental play against his hand, but they don't need to because they're not the cards I'm going to hold on to. My 2676, it's actually been extremely relevant that it controls his 5873, the 5 upward. So I think I have more incidental stuff in my favor, and I think specifically I do on my high-level cards. Though his 8847 has real play against my 8784. And those are very often the last two cards, key cards remaining, and I have to be quite careful about that. The other thing is, I don't really see, like, let's say I had first turn on this board. If I play 2621 and 7, I think that's just a really difficult move for him to meet. I threaten 2126 and 4. If 8847 is Dark Elemental, which I think it is, then he does admittedly have a capture in 8, but I have multiple ways to plus wall back in 9. And so I can create, using a level 1, a real challenge for him while keeping my power cards on the board. I don't want to play 2126 and 9, because 2517 controls that. But I think 7 is really appealing, just because it's genuinely hard for his hand to handle. Right? If there's an element in 8, it just already has a ton of trouble taking it. And even if there isn't, his ways of taking it are kind of limited. 2517, I have this combo back with 2126. And the other cards, I either have combos back, or they're using a powerful card, or both. And so I think it just puts serious pressure. I also kind of threaten to go in 8 if I start 2621 and 7. If I go an 8, he has 4 cards that can capture my card in 7 from 4, and I have combo play against all of them if I play 2, 1, 2, 6, and 8. So I really threaten to build out from that starter, and I think that makes it extremely dangerous for him, that I can use 2 level 1s and make serious threats while keeping the better cards in my hand. The other move that appeals to me, not 2, 1, 2, 6, and 9, because 2, 5, 1, 7 covers it, but 2126 and 3 also seems genuinely really dangerous for him. Because if the right side of the board fills up, I really think the 8784 and 8828 combo will be devastating. I think those are very powerful. And the most dangerous thing he's done in a game to me was when he started 2517 and 9. And if I start 2126 and 3 and he plays 2517 and 9, I think I just take it in 6. Just looking at it here. And so, yeah, I think 3 and 7 are both really appealing starters for me, and I hope I someday get a first turn chance to try it. This would have been a very nice board for me to get first turn on, I think. I'm not sure which I would have gone with. The ice plus and 6. No, but my 8/7/8/4 covers. Yeah. I'm not sure if I'd have gone 3 or 7 if I had this board. But those are the two moves I'm thinking about if I ever get starter. And I do think they line up well. Now, he may change his hand, but we have both kind of locked into what we're doing. And I think we're both curious to see what happens when I get first turn. He thinks... He mentioned that he would... you know, wants to see what happens when I run out of power more quickly, right? You're not able to hold on to as many cards on first turn. I think my first turn potential starters are really strong. And it'll be interesting to see what happens there. But we both kind of have our theory of the rule set and of the hand that works, and we both kind of locked in. And possibly hopping around would be better. But I think one thing Deli does is he really likes to get to know a hand. And so while that can make him a bit of a target, usually the hands he likes are quite dynamic. If they weren't, he would stop liking them, and he would stop playing them. And he gets a feel for them, and you can kind of target what he's doing, but he'll also then have more experience with the hand than you do with your counter hand attempt. I'm getting pretty comfortable, I think, with my hand, and I like what it can do. And it switching to 8/7/8/4 means if they start 2/5/1/7/9, I think I go 3, and I think I'm okay there. That was the idea. I don't know. You look at the hands and you start thinking about starters and stuff, and you think, do I have a response I'm happy with? And I like how my hand lines up, and I want to stick with it and want to try to take advantage of what I think is a matchup advantage. But I could very easily be wrong about that. That's, you know, one of the interesting triple triad things. But I do really think, looking at this board, if I can play Cockatrice in 3 or Earthworm Thing in 7, I can apply real pressure. And I haven't really gotten to apply pressure. There have been a couple L's where he had to be a little careful, but not that careful, and then I had to be careful on the next move anyway. Like, you know, the only game where there were serious winning chances was game 2, and that was firmly in his favor. And that's why I cannot run a hand that doesn't have better coverage of 2/5/1/7 than I did that game, which is why 8/7/8/4 is in the hand. So yeah, that's where I'm, you know, this will be coming out months after, but I wanted to get down my thoughts on the hand and what I was trying to do and where I thought our kind of strengths and weaknesses are. Because right now I don't really think I can beat him unless I catch him on a hand effect, and I think this is the right hand to try to catch him. And so that's where I think I'm at. We've now played twice in open tournaments of recent. Well, TTAC wasn't really open because I did advance winning the closed games. We didn't play the open, but we played 6, 7 open games there. And, like, checking after, the solver said, yeah, we played perfectly the whole time. And not only did Deli play flawlessly, but, like, as I picked counter hands that created difficulties for him, he kept, like, playing the exact perfect move. Like, you know, I start in 9, and there's, like, a response in 3 that's fine, you know, it survives, but it's under pressure. There's a response in 5, it survives, but it's under pressure. And he plays the response in 1 that just kills the pressure immediately. And so it was not just that he played, like, no losing moves. It was that he killed pressure as quickly as possible, as precisely as possible. And I feel like we're perhaps in a similar situation here. Oh, one other thing on Deli's play. I think he adjusts really well to how I play. He's done this in the past. There's a starter he played in 4 against me once that really messed with my head. But I think he is... because we often do find the same moves, I think he usually understands what kind of moves I'm looking at and is very good at looking for moves that will be hard for me to face. And I think he plays, you know, I don't think I'm the opponent, like he, And I'm not saying, like, he plays on this whole different level against me. Like, I think I will never be his rival in the way that, like, Seto is, you know? I'm not saying, like, ooh, me versus Deli, this is the ultimate rivalry. Like, I think Deli versus Seto, me versus Yojimbo were the two, you know, really special ones that we were part of. But, and obviously, like, he has a good rivalry with me and a good rivalry with Yojimbo and, you know, vice versa. But I think he adapts in a really effective way to how I play, because I think basically he could play like, more stylistically like me if he wanted to. And thus he has a good sense of how to play against that, because he knows what kind of moves I want quite well. And I think there's no one who's adapted to how I play as effectively as Deli has in the Rebirth, which is why Deli has a plus record against me in the Rebirth in open games. And pretty confident no one else does. Like, Piggy has a good record too. It's Deli and Piggy have the good records against me. But I think it's Deli. I think it's Deli by some margin. And yeah, he's a really tough opponent. And I hope I catch him here, because I think I did figure out the rule set. And I think I can play that well enough that I have real winning chances if I get first turn and the elements line up. And, you know, he has a very good chance to hold there, but I think I also have a real chance to apply significant pressure. And as we've learned from looking at numbers here, no one facing extreme pressure survives more than a few games. No one's that precise. So, yeah, that's where we're at.